Hello everyone, so it's Martin here, the man of Yorke. I've returned and it's May. Summertime is blooming and swifts have returned back to this part of the riverbank and I've returned as well with them. I've been taking lots of footage but not been editing many videos much at all. But hopefully, even though I'm a little bit behind, you'll enjoy the next few videos that I'm going to bring out. I've been doing lots of reading of history as usual. Lots of writing and basically just weathering out the winter, and it has been a long winter, hasn't it, this year. I've also been reminiscing as well because I've been watching back on a few of my old videos that I did when I first started all this, and I often notice that there's kind people who will go back and watch or re-watch those videos, and I'm hoping that this video will be a little bit more in those style ones, like when I went to look at the place where I grew up, or walking to work in Yorke and things, walking the walls of Wareham. And so this video is about a beautiful historical church that me and Rachel visited, and it's in a local to us called Aldworth, a little Berkshire village, and it's got the most astounding medieval tomb in it. And so I thought I'd put together a little historical segment for you to enjoy in the middle. And also, I find it quite relevant because the period of history that that we cover in that historical bit is the same period of history that I'm writing my novel about. So I thought that at the end I would insert an audio recording of a chapter that I wrote of my historical novel I'm writing. You know, it's not a masterpiece, but you might enjoy it. But it's a chapter I'm going to take out, a particularly violent one. And basically, just as a little treat, really. After all, this channel is very eclectic, isn't it? Like, oh, anything can happen, really, can't it? I think someone who will enjoy this video is a guy who's been very kind on Instagram to share my channel and things. Is Rob the Church Crawler. So I'll give a shout out back to you, mate. Do check out his channel, he's really good. And he does little short videos all about historic churches, and he's going to do some walking videos as well. So if you enjoy that kind of thing, check him out, he's really good. So anyway, this is I'm going to take you back in time to the bitter winter, and when it was really cold, and my face felt like it was stretched across my skull. I could barely smile on that day because it was so cold. And the footage might be a little bit exposed-ish, that's for sure. But hopefully you'll get something from it and still enjoy it. So I hope you enjoy the video and have a lovely week. And if you do want to post a comment, you're more than welcome to. And have a chin wag and have a lovely time. It's Martin here, the man of Yorke, and Rachel too. She's holding the wire to stop it blowing away because it's very windy. So yeah, it's quite a cold walk today, and about 8.8 kilometres. We're going around Berkshire, and we're going to be passing through a little village called Aldworth. It's going to be really nice, and I've got my fingers crossed that the church will be open, because there's some really interesting effigies called the Giants in there, which are these really huge medieval funerary effigies. So hopefully, fingers crossed, we'll be able to see those. But other than that, we think it's going to be a very nice walk in the Chilterns to North Wessex Downs, and it should be good. So as you can see, I've got a lovely chalk down just behind me. My favourite kind of landscape down south here. So we're literally just over the northwest of these downs, because just over River Thames, it's the Chilterns, and then you get over onto this side and we're into the downs. The ridgeway is a very long trackway, of course, but we're only going to do a section of it, but I'd really like to do the whole thing one day. It passes so many interesting places and so many beautiful national parks. As was just saying to Rachel how I really want to do the Ridgeway, like the full thing, and camp along the way of it. But Rachel doesn't want to do it. Why don't you want to do it?
I just think it would be boring.
What?
No, I just think we've done a lot of it already, it's four sections, so it would be key. And I like map reading, and it's so obvious that you're on it, although I did just think we were still on the Ridgeway, and we're not. But I just think you can't get lost on it, really.
Long track, chalky track, isn't it? Yeah.
So not fine, you can't get lost.
And so your main thing is that you like navigation the most, don't you? So Rachel's in charge of navigation and I'm not allowed to her.
I was just saying to Martin, he's not allowed out without me because he will get lost and never come back.
It's actually true as well, actually.
Oh, my mouth is freezing up.
In fact, I think we're just frozen out now. Yeah. The wind is right in our faces, so we're just like...
I can't speak.
So we're in luck, the church is open, and as you can see how huge the effigies are in here, and how they dominate the church as well, like literally like, they're just all over the place, they're so huge and gigantic. I've never quite seen medieval effigies like it, and presented in such a way.
Anyway, I've been round the effigies and I've put together the family tree. So, over here, this is great-granddad, Sir Robert de Lavesh.
And he was made a knight in Edward I's reign, was allowed to have a castle here in the manor.
Yeah, and then we have his two sons, Sir John de Lavesh and Philip de Lavesh. He's a giant, seven foot. And look how big his tomb is.
I know, he's dragon.
Effigy. Yeah. Is it an effigy too?
Yeah, effigy.
Right, then he married. Then Philip married Jane.
This is a very fine effigy of the lady here, Joan.
Yeah. And then Joan had three sons. The first son was this guy over here. And yeah. Sir John de Lavesh.
The one who was attainted in Edward's second reign.
Second son is over there.
And that's Philippe.
Is it Philippe?
Yep.
Philippe. And then the third one is over here. Mrs. Nicholas. And he was the custodian of the King Edward III's first son, who's Black Prince. Pretty cool.
Yeah, pretty awesome.
Pretty cool. And then going back to the first son.
About Sir
he married
Jean.
His lady wife, Lady Isabella.
Isabella over here.
And then they had one kid, the only child that's in here anyway, over here. So this is John, he is the grandson of his great granddad, who was
Sir
first.
Oh, yeah.
It's pretty cool.
The de Lavesh family tomb in Aldworth is one of the most complete medieval family tombs in England. Aldworth was the seat of the de Lavesh family, who had built a small castle here at the centre of their manor. Victorian excavations of the old castle, now dominated by Aldworth Manor, revealed a beautiful silver seal matrix once belonging to Isabella de Lavesh, which she must have lost almost 700 years ago.
There are 9 14th century effigies in total, and these tell us a story about a noble family of knightly class who lived in a dramatic time period between the chaotic reign of Edward II and the chivalric reign of Edward III. The oldest effigy is Sir John, who was knighted by the great Hammer of the Scots, Edward I. Also can be seen are his sons Philip and John. Philip's effigy is huge, and according to folklore, he was almost 7 foot tall. At his feet is represented a dwarf who accompanied him to court to further exaggerate his size. The great man was the Sheriff of Berkshire and had 6 children who would accompany him into rebellion and almost ruin. Sir Philip's England was a troubled kingdom. After the death of Edward I, his inept son Edward II angered the greatest and most powerful magnates in England by favouring certain friends and upstarts in court. Firstly, Piers Gaveston and then Hugh de Spencer. Most damaging to Edward's prestige was his failure to dominate Scotland. The devastating defeat at the Battle of Bannockburn saw England on the back foot, and Scottish armies began pillaging the north of England, reaching almost as far down as Lancaster and York, resulting in that embarrassing White Battle where York's hinterland was raided. The castles of Northumberland, Durham and Cumberland were strained, and Edward, leading an extravagant lifestyle, left the north of England defenceless and underfunded. It wasn't long before ambitious members of the royal family, like the Earl of Lancaster, were in open rebellion. It seems that Philip and his sons sided with Lancaster's rebellion. It is likely that the Beshes had a form of fealty connection with this great earl, or may have just sympathised with his cause, given Edward's bad lordship. This led these knights of tall stature to take part in a battle far to the north in Yorkshire, the Battle of Boroughbridge. It is tantalising to wonder what grievances these Berkshire giants had with the king, which would lead them so far north to topple him. This, of course, was a mistake. They tied their fortunes to a bold gamble which did not pay off, as a battle fought in 1322 was a defeat for the rebels. In the aftermath of the battle, the De La Beshes were captured. Sir Philip's eldest son, also called Philip, was detained in Scarborough Castle, and his other son John was imprisoned in the Tower of London. The family were fortunate, however, as history favoured them. They were pardoned and released by Edward III in 1327 after the mother of the new king, Isabella, and her lover Mortimer seized the throne of her husband, Edward II. It is believed that under the stronger rule of Edward III, the family stayed loyal and enjoyed this return of England's prosperity. John became the Sheriff of Berkshire, and his younger brother, Nicholas, became a Seneschal of Gascony, a highly important position. He also went on to become the Constable of the Tower of London and the custodian of the King's eldest son, the Black Prince, in his infancy. He was also granted the right to crenellate the De La Beche Manor House and turn it into a small castle. It may have been this Nicholas who paid for these monuments of his family before his line became extinct with no male heirs. In folklore, the giant effigies became known as the Aldworth Giants for their great stature. Their original names were forgotten, becoming known as John Long, John Strong, John Ever Afraid, and John Never Afraid. These legendary monuments were badly damaged by parliamentarian soldiers in their iconoclasms during the Civil War, but fortunately, it did not ruin their story.
So just look at that yew tree just behind. So it's apparently, experts think that it was planted around the 5th century. Just imagine the things it must have seen, like it was here before the church and
and will probably last just as longer. Crazy.
What are you doing to that tree?
Rachel just caught me in the bushes looking suspicious when I was filming that burl. It apparently looks quite dodgy.
Yeah. Anyway, I think you're in the bushes.
As I get a bit too close and personal, that yew tree. So that church is absolutely amazing. Like, I've never seen effigies that size and also with that many kind of all the same family, for one thing, the Lebesh family. Like, and all sort of the same sort of time period as well. It was like really intriguing to see how they were all faring in that really kind of tumultuous time period around Edward II to Edward III's reign, when all the nobles were taking sides in the various kind of civil conflicts at that time. But so really amazing. And then having that 5th century yew tree as well is really cool as well. You know, I probably got a little bit too excited, didn't I, Rachel? Right, so we're just warming up in the car and we've got our coffee and tea. It actually got really bitter by the end, like my hands were freezing, so it's certainly still winter and you can feel it. We're just about to start reading our books in the car, and what we're reading at the moment, Rachie?
We're reading James Herriot.
Yes, I'm on the first one and you're on the, which one are you on?
I'm on the third one.
Yeah, so it's like, they're like memoirs of a vet that lived in Yorkshire, so I'm imagining all the nice Yorkshire dales and things, so it's really nice to read. Speaking of Yorkshire, like, when I get home I want to find out what happened to those two knights who were represented in those effigies in the Aldworth Church, because I've got a feeling that maybe they might have been attainted in Edward VI's reign because of the involvement in the Battle of Boroughbridge, Bridge, which would be quite cool because we lived quite close to Boroughbridge Bridge when we lived in York, so it would be quite a nice home connection. Strange for two Berkshire knights to be involved in these kind of like northern politics, but then again, I suppose it was English politics in those days, actually. Anyway, so I hope you enjoyed the walk. There's lots of nice bleak scenery and lots of history and things. If you liked it, do like the video, and if you want to add anything or tell me anything, feel free to comment. I always like to reply to everyone. And so from us, goodbye then.
Sewell rolled ahead. Beyond Cotch Oliford on this side of the Tyne, the tracks became wild and untamed, and not suitable for a cart as big. They were following a stream with woodland on either side, and the heavy cart horse was struggling through the mud. The air was so damp Sewell was wearing thick woollens against the cold. The ground beneath his horse's hooves was churned with soft mud. Otto yawned as he swayed to the rhythm of the cart, and was lulled by the trickle of the stream. Through bleary eyes the squire looked past the burn at the damp trees, noticing some men seemingly working on either side, before nodding his head back in slumber. He barely noticed when the fat carter slumped into his reins with an arrow protruding from his neck, blood pumping onto the horses.
Otto, jump!
Suddenly Otto was jolted awake in confusion as the horse screamed and hot blood gushed onto his lap. He threw himself off the cart, landing roughly onto the wet ground, and crawled beneath it as another arrow thudded dangerously close into the wood.
"Give us your possessions or you'll get an arrow too," shouted a rough voice from across the burn.
Otto could see men flitting between the trees. Some wore hoods, most had longbows. The carter's blood seeped from the top of the cart, streaming into the mud. Saul had dismounted and was sheltering behind the cart, sword drawn.
"Otto, how many?"
"Fünf, sechs," he shouted back in Germany.
"In English, you're still practicing,"
Saul joked. It fell short from the German boy, who shrugged dramatically.
"Come out and we'll spare your lives," a voice yelled across the stream.
Saul didn't reply and directed his squire. "I'll jump out and distract them, and you grab your crossbow."
"Ready?"
Saul jumped out from behind the cart, sword drawn. "Murderers!" he screamed. In reply, an arrow whipped past his face. He dived back behind the vehicle.
Otto, meanwhile, scrambled onto the cart and dragged his quiver and bow from the luggage, narrowly avoiding another arrow. "Don't play games, knight. There's 10 of us, all with bows. Give us your belongings or we'll slay thee both." "Come and get it!" Saul shouted back decisively.
Otto shoved his crossbow back into the ground and put his foot through the loop. He bent down and used his strength to drag the catskin string up to the catch. He reached for a bolt.
Scheiße!
It was the wrong quiver, filled with specialist whistling missiles. These were designed to strike fear into the enemy, but not as accurate. They would have to do.
"Otto, these are desperate men. Make an example of one. They'll probably run," Sewell directed.
Otto laid on the ground beneath the cart and laid a whistling bolt onto the notch. The brigands began peppering the cart with arrows, and two men began to wade through the stream. Otto took aim at one. A bearded man with an axe was struggling on the loose stones. The squire breathed in, aimed, and pressed the lever. The cord released with a crack, and a bolt shrieked with high-pitched scream across the burn, flying harmlessly above the bandit's head. Otto was out of practice.
"Fucking hell, what was that?" shouted one of the brigands.
The men crossing the stream faltered, looking upwards in reaction to the alien noise of a missile. The pause was enough for Otto to draw his crossbow back up and load another bolt. Scrabbling up the bank, one of the bandits wielding a billhook had reached the cart, but Otto saw his feet and sprung up with his strong legs and sidestepped out from behind the cart. He shouldered the butt. The bandit stood in front of him, gawping. Click went the lever, and with a scream, the bolt cracked sickeningly into the man's face, his head whipping back in a mist of blood.
"Shit! Shit!"
the bearded brigand echoed from the stream.
"He's dead!"
There were shouts of anger, and more arrows flew sporadically over the cart, bandits whipping arrows across the valley.
"Are they surrendering?" Otto asked, back behind the cart.
"Think we just pissed them off," said the knight. "Good kills, by the way." Anger was boiling over amongst the bandits, who were no doubt starving men. Their leader shouted to his men,
"Bring me their fucking heads!"
Otto loaded up another crossbow bolt and squinted between the cart and the floor and saw bandits armed with clubs and axes wading through the river. One had an old sword and they all wore padded jacks of protection. He aimed and released another bolt as the bearded bandit. His aim was true, as with a piercing shriek it struck him through the chest and he fell backwards into a stream of red water lapping at the thighs of his comrades. Sodden and enraged, they charged at the bank, and Otto drew his sword and stuck it point down into the ground next to him, ready to fight hand to hand, and quickly strained at the bowstring, his heart pounding. He could hear the slopping of wet boots coming close. He fumbled another bolt in place just as one of the malignants rounded the side of the cart, snarling with a hideous expression. His ears had obviously been cut off for theft, because there were just congealed stumps on the side of his head. In a moment he fell back choking with a bolt through his throat as Otto had released from the hip, then in one move dropped the crossbow and tugged his wicked-edged sword from the ground. On the other side, a bandit had made an assault on Sewell with a stolen sword in hand. The exchange was over within seconds. Sewell had trained with a Teutonic knight from a boy, and the bandit's only skill was savagery. They did not know how to wield such a noble weapon, for as soon as the bandit swung at the knight, Sewell paced to the right, parrying effortlessly with his sword level towards the victim, and using the bandit's own momentum and the force of his step, Sewell thrust his point into the bandit's head, the point splitting through his skull as easily as it would a vegetable. It was textbook. To the left, Otto cut through the wet wrist of his opponent. The bandit had overreached himself and, screaming in agony, was silenced as a squire back cut through his head. The cuts were swift. There was no time for the pair to even acknowledge the assailants as men. It seemed like butchery.
Sewell was already rolling onto the next opponent and cut through their shoulder with the sharp steel of his sword before pacing onto the next, whose sweeping club he knocked aside with an upward parry, the steel quivering, then swept the shuddering blade onto his neck, cutting through into his spine. Cries of fear were heard, an arrow was loosed, and the sound of men running. "They're running, sir," Otto beamed. "Well done, Otto, good shooting and swordplay." Sewell wiped his own sword on the grass before picking up the club and coolly bashed in the head of his last opponent, who was seemingly still alive. Sewell grimaced. It was a grisly event, and he did not like to so easily cut down men like animals, but it was the only way to keep the roads tame. It was drilled into a crusader that the Christian duty was to tame the land of savagery. The only way to do that was with organized savagery. The chaotic attack was easily dispatched by cool-headed technique with the sword. Otto examined the corpse of a carter and asked with his usual Christian compassion, "Vel, who's going to drive now?" He was answered by Sewell's finger pointed at the squire.